One final piece of proof was needed. A DNA match. With the media gathering for the announcement, Turi gave us the answer.
So, if you look at the DNA of Michael and you look at the DNA from the skeletal remains, there's a match.
Wow.
Blimey.
And I can now tell you, there is a DNA match between the maternal DNA from the descendants of the family of Richard III and the skeletal remains that we found at the Greyfriars dig.
And the following day, I go off to a forensics conference in Innsbruck. And I'm saying, oh, don't worry, it's not going to be that exciting anyways. This is going to be a 90-year-old friar who lived a nice long life and died in his bed, right? So I text Jo when I land in Innsbruck, and I go, how's our 90-year-old friar? And she texts back going, youngish male, head injuries, hunchback. And
all you need to do is breathe on these remains or touch them, and you're putting your DNA all over it. So one of the things I'm really worried about is contamination. So I need you to spit into that, up to that line. It's actually going to take you longer.
That's a lot of spit.
It is. It'll take you quite a long time to actually do. And then we're going to close the lid. That's got a buffer in it that will keep the DNA nice and happy. And then I'm going to take it back to the UK to do analysis.
I'm going to do this.
Yeah, I'd go off. Take your time.
Well, this is amazing. So look, over here, we've got, looks like a tooth here. Another one underneath there, so it's looking good. It's looking like we've got some teeth here that we'll be able to do DNA analysis with. It's amazing.
I think that's one of the really important things about this program particularly, is that we show that actually DNA testing can have unexpected outcomes.
Right.
And I think that's actually really, really important in that I know that, you know, some other television series, what they do is they'll start with sort of 100 people and then they'll narrow down, they'll show the ones that they really want to show. What we do is we choose the people at the beginning. And we follow them all the way through their story. Yeah. And we are really privileged to be a part of that.
Right, so the other half of your father's DNA, again, very, very clear. And it's from Northern Ireland.
Not too far away.
Okay, listen, I wasn't expecting that one.
So it is in South Down and North Louth. So
right.
In this area. Here. So whereabouts do you guys live?
We grew up here and we now live. So South Down is where we grew up.
So basically where you guys grew up.
That's strange. I never once expected that.
We were surprised. It's like a bunch of typists, and what they have to do is our DNA is kind of like a book, and they have to copy this book out. So I've got a little thing here. So if I was to give you that and say, can you copy that out for me? Can you do it without any mistakes? This is just one page. But if you think about our DNA, it's actually about 1.6 million of these pages. So as you can imagine, mistakes happen a lot. For example, this might change to a G or a T, but you can have mutations that happen and they have no effect whatsoever.
Jack of the drawer, isn't it?
Yeah. And you can have other mutations that you might go on to get a really serious disease because of it. One thing to remember is that your surname can have more than one origin. My surname King could come from someone who worked for the king, or as a nickname for someone who merely behaved as if he was one. So whatever your surname, Shepherd, Andrews, Eccleston, Orchard, or Swift, your surname contains within it a glimpse into the life of one of your ancestors.